That first day, I practically couldn't look at milk. I'd milked 3 cows, alone, all by myself. And I couldn't eat. I was tired, and I didn't feel yet that I belonged. It's like that at first. First, I remembered that I finally knew how to milk, that I could do it, and it made me feel good. But then I started to worry about Farmer Perry. Maybe he'd expect me to do all kinds of things. And then, in a week, he'd tell me to go home to Mother. It wasn't only Mother, but the boys on the team who said I was just plain nuts to go. And Tom, who always said the kid's getting too big for his breeches. I have no idea how strange it is to grip a plow for the first time. The wonderful feeling it gives you. You've got to be steady on your feet, and you've got to have foresight to see the next furrow ahead and try to cut it clean. Uncle Perry turned out to be a prince, master of his little kingdom and the land he loved. He understood boys and knew you couldn't learn to run a plow on the sidewalks of the city. So he taught us, me and Barbara, how to plow. She had a feeling for farm work, picked it up right away. I realized it wasn't just me and Barbara doing this work for the first time, but hundreds of us from towns and cities, for you think of a farmer as merely the chap who grows the food you eat. Boys and girls, not just in Vermont, but in every state of the Union, harvesting for the first time. When the fields could be left alone, we'd cut wood. And then the logs must be stacked. A cord of wood is 8 feet long, 4 feet high, and 4 feet wide, Uncle Perry told us. Good farmers, he said, stack it neatly like bricks, so the wet and moisture can't get through. We tried to show him we were good farmers. Then you light a fire with one of the logs from one of the trees you felled yourself. And somehow it burns differently, and the water it heats feels lots better. And that card from Jack saying he wanted me to come and play golf with him. Chasing a ball when there's a war to be won and a man's work to do. Next year, I thought, I'll make Jack come up here with me. So, instead of answering him, I decided to send him some snapshots. They weren't very good, and I couldn't make up my mind which to send. Because I took most of them myself. We had an awful lot of fun. First, me working. Well, maybe working isn't quite the name for it. And then, Barbara. She's beautiful, isn't she? This was the cow that made history. She's the first one I ever milked. This is my first boss. I don't know why I ever wasted a film on him. This was taking at Thompson's Corners at the barn dance. That's me over there and back. This is the time we went to the county fair. The fair's over there, to the right. Then we had some amateur tumbling. Some of the boys were real good, too. This is the 4-H Club Orchestra. And this, Uncle Perry took of us one Sunday after church. By the end of August, the Perry kitchen was home for me. And boy, does farming build up your appetite. How different from that first evening. How friendly to sit with the Perrys and Barbara after a hard day's work. And this land was now mine, just as I was part of it. Mother wrote that I ought to have a couple weeks off before going back to school, to rest up, she said. She didn't know we'd had a frost the night before, and that we had to get our corn in the next day or lose a summer's work. When I got to the store one morning, there was a phone call from her. She didn't realize that if I left, it meant that Uncle Perry and Ma and Barbara would have to do the whole job alone. Because every farm needed hands, and neighbors had to do their own work, just didn't have time to pitch in and help. She didn't know that I felt I couldn't just go off like that and leave my corn, which I'd plowed and sowed and weeded, for someone else to harvest. I'll have a vacation when I go back to school, I told her. I haven't got time to take a vacation now. Frost hadn't been heavy, and just nipped the corn. But a couple of more nights with a heavier frost, that would be too bad. We had to cut our corn by hand. The corn cutter was broken and we couldn't get new parts. The steel is going into guns and there just aren't enough replacements for farm machinery. The short scythe is hard on your fingers and wrists. You've got to cut in a stoop position and you got an awful crick in your back. And it's got to be finished. No time to waste. Heavier frosts are coming and they could ruin our rich golden corn. We worked against time, early and late, all of us. Uncle Perry and Ma and Barbara and me. Then Barbara fed the corn into the chopper, where all the leaves and kernels are ground to a wet mash, blown into the silo stored for cattle feed during the winter. I was up in the silo where the wet mash settles on you like a lukewarm blizzard. Gets into your hair, your eyes, and up your nose. You can't see and you can't breathe and it just keeps coming down on you as if it'll never stop. Hard work. Yes, it's hard work, some of it, but it's worthwhile. Makes you feel good to know you can do your share. And of course, it's not all work. And it's not the work you remember. The joy of living on the land.
Oh.
I'll be back there again. Back at work as one of the thousands of fellows and girls who signed up with the Victory Farm Volunteers all over the country. I'll be back because I know now what America really means.
No, only the beginning of Uncle Sam's long road to victory. He needs the Army, needs the Navy, needs the Marine Corps, needs the Air Corps, needs the Tank Corps, and he needs the U.S. Crop Corps. Join the Victory Farm Volunteer. Join now. See your school principal or ask your county agent.